And of course, it seems that throughout history, there have been individuals and groups, even as you mentioned, the people who came over on the Mayflower, who had this sense of what you call freedom, but really what it is a direct line to whatever the spiritual force is, not having to go through an intercessor like a priest or King James in that case.
Yeah, exactly.
And that was probably why they were able to recognize the indigenous spirituality when they got here.
Yeah, it was exactly. And so the America, the founding fathers of America, were inspired individuals. These were inspired individuals. This nation was founded by these people who had this direct connection, and the native people. See, with the relationship with the native people that occurred in Plymouth, that 50 years, and really throughout New England, throughout New England to a much much lesser extent. But what one can say is, and what someone told me from Boston, who was head of the old state house in Boston, he said, by the time 1776 came, you had the American mind. It was completely different from the mind, the mentality of the mainland European. Okay, these are Europeans who had been on this land for 150 years. Mm-hmm. And what is the difference? The Native Americans. Okay, their relationship, and this man said this, I didn't prompt him. He said this to me, okay? And he said that because of the relationship with the Native American, by 1776, the American mind was significantly different from the European mind. Now that's critical in our understanding of the role of the Native people, of the role of this high vibe, this higher understanding in the evolution of this nation.
So how did we devolve from that? Because again, there was that, and of course it certainly was not a perfect society, but as you say, I want to emphasize that there were some very, very specific differences. I mean, in reading, for example, Thomas Jefferson's diary as a child, he traveled with his father, who was Peter Jefferson, who was a surveyor, and they would often stop and stay with and converse with various chiefs and native peoples. And so that was the influence that Thomas Jefferson had in his boyhood.
There you go.
And it was probably similar for so many people.
Yeah.
People in Europe didn't bathe. They believed bathing was bad for the health. And so to see white people coming, who are essentially skinny dipping with the natives, this was a shock to the European system.
Uh-huh.
And so there was a different creature that got created here. And so
absolutely.
The next question is, over the period of 220 years or so, how did we devolve into just another empire?
Okay, well, our belief is that what's happening right now in America and the world is a natural outcome of our misunderstanding of the nature of the universe. Okay, it's a natural outcome of Darwinian principles, of Descartesian principles, and all that. So, it's not a conspiracy. It's an evolution of understanding that we had to go through this process to understand ourselves, to understand our beliefs, and understand that they are erroneous. They don't work. And now the systems that were created on these erroneous beliefs, and we call them a house of cards built on a false foundation. The house of cards is starting to crumble.
Sure, the house of credit cards is certainly coming down.
Yeah, but it's the whole thing is scarcity based, all right? It's scarcity is antithetical to the true nature of the universe. And then in the native cosmology, you won't see native people hoarding, okay? Saving. The whole concept of saving, this nation is built on the concept of saving. Well, the concept of saving is doubt based. is fear-based. What are you saving for? A rainy day. What are you saving for? To have more money than the other guy so that the other guy doesn't have power and control over you. But guess what? If we understood that it is an abundant universe, that there's more abundance than we can fathom in the universe, then why do we need to save? Why do we need to hoard? Why would somebody who's got more than me have power and control over me? Because I have access to everything, you know? So this is key. The whole economic theory is built on the concept of scarcity, economics 101. I have a degree in economics from UC Berkeley. And the problem of scarcity is the foundation of our economic theory. Well, if you spend some time around Native people, you'll see them giving everything away.
Sure, there's the giveaway.
There's the giveaway. Okay, giveaway is the essence of abundance. That's one of my bumper stickers. Okay, I came from a family, the Baxter family in Maine. They were visionary governors and mayors who gave away the family fortune to the people of Maine in the form of Mount Katahdin, the sacred mountain of the Native people there, and 200,000 acres and all kinds of libraries and buildings and all kinds of stuff, because they lived according to a different set of rules. They gave it all away, and that's what set me on my path. I'm like, okay, what are these guys? What's driving these guys? That they're not hoarding and giving it down through the family. They're giving it away. Well,
and with certainly a little intercision here that your family, these were Republicans.
These were Republicans. These were white, wealthy, male Republican politicians. My great-great-grandfather and his son, Percival Baxter, who gave Baxter State Park to the people of Maine. And interestingly enough, James Phinney Baxter, my great-great-grandfather, who started the whole philanthropic giveaway thing, was also a historian. He built a library in the state of Portland, Maine, and went to find books on the founding of New England and couldn't find any. He spent the next 30 years becoming one of the top historians of the founding of New England, and actually is today recognized as one of the main historians of this period. And what one thing one can see, what he discovered and is not known, is the story of Squanto. That Squanto was a Native American in New England who Sir Fernando Gorges, who founded the state of Maine, took as an honored guest to England. He lived with Sir Fernando Gorges so Gorges could study his ways, okay, so they could understand the Native thinking. Gorges brought Squanto back to New England, and then Squanto went again to England. Squanto went several times to England, and then he came back with a dermer, and then a gentleman named Hunt actually took him as a prisoner, Squanto, and took him off to Spain. So this is the one that's known. That Squanto was taken off to Spain as a slave by this Hunt person. Well, no one knows that before Hunt, Squanto had been in England as an honored guest. And so Squanto, when the Pilgrims landed in 1620, Squanto was living with Massasoit and liked the English and created this bridge between this visionary Massasoit and these Pilgrims. So one can see the hand of the divine if one chooses to look, okay? And this is a very important point, I think, now, because I think with the sort of the reign of the Noam Chomsky's and the those guys that you know, the People's Republic of America, the People's Story of America or whatever, we've looked at the seamy side of America now, you know?
We have to look at the seamy side.
The seamy side, yeah, exactly. And we have a choice. We can look at the shadow or we can look at the light. That's our choice. We have free will. And we are bringing forth in our book, The Trust Frequency, that choice will determine your reality. It will determine your frequency, and it will determine your reality. So that's what we're given, is free choice. So we can have as miserable a life as we want, and we can have as amazing life as we want, depending on our choices.
For more on these ideas, go to theamericanevolution.com, thetrustfrequency.net, thesearchofthefuturemovie.com, theinstituteatsedona.com, thebaxterproject.org, or YouTube channels, The American Evolution, The Trust Frequency, Fly W. Eagle, In Search of the Future, Peace Healing America, The Institute. Onward to peace on Earth. For more from Swami, go to the Department of Heartland Security.org and join the uprising.